Hey everyone, Rob from Frugal Radio here. Just doing a spot of recording tonight at the theater. What can you pick up with your SDR? Well, let's have a listen and see.
Mayday, America 953, declared emergency.
It was a week before Christmas when I shot this video, and the timeless show A Christmas Carol was playing. I arrived about 15 minutes before the start of the performance, took a seat in the lobby, and started setting up my equipment. I brought my old Dell laptop, an AirSpy R2 software-defined radio, which would show up to 8 MHz of bandwidth on the display at once, very useful when searching for transmissions across a large range of frequencies, and I also had my trusty RTL-SDR dipole kit. But my first fail of the night was forgetting to bring my headphones. Unfortunately, there were several other fails, but if you stick with me throughout this video, you'll see I was able to receive some signals during my night at the theatre. The first thing I tried to find was the production team intercom channel. Generally, the show producer or director will be wearing a headset that allows them to communicate with the sound and light team, special effects guys, and stage hands or other backstage personnel. It is possible to hear lighting cues, audio cues, and more. There is often a lot of conversation happening before the show begins, throughout the show, even during the intermissions as props get moved around and the stage is reset for the next act.
Cast has given us the clearance. Okay, so stand by. So, Rosie, you can go whenever you're ready. And stand by LX2 and house out. Oh no, bye. Okay, LX2 and house out, go.
When staff are moving around in different areas of the theatre, they will use belt packs like the TELUS and ClearCom units shown here. On my last trip to this theatre, the belt pack receive frequency was 510.6 MHz in wide FM mode. The producer's mic was permanently hot, so everything that was said in the control booth was broadcast over that frequency. Before the show began, I heard the producer commenting on all kinds of things, from dealing with technical issues to passing comments on clothing worn by audience members. During the show, I heard cues like, "Snow machine in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. And then the inevitable happened and the snow started falling on the stage. On that occasion, the channel was very active from 15 minutes before the show until the end, and it made for a lot of extra entertainment during the performance. So, sitting in the lobby with my laptop and SDR hardware, I started searching for active frequencies in the 500 to 750 MHz range. I had just started when a security guard approached and informed me I would have to leave. It turned out that because of the pandemic, health and safety measures, the lobby was closed to the public and the theatre was only accessible to ticket holders who had to remain in the auditorium except at the intermission. This was my second fail of the night, which resulted in me having to actually leave the premises. It was minus 25 degrees Celsius or minus 13 Fahrenheit outside, but I decided to brave the weather and to try to monitor from outside. I started searching for radio mics, also known as cordless or wireless mics. These devices are typically hidden in the actor and actress's clothing and use radio signals to transmit audio to the sound engineer. The numbers on the front of these three units are showing the current transmit frequency, although they can often show a channel number or group number instead of a frequency. During my time standing outside near the back of the theatre, I searched the 500 to 750 meg bands for radio signals. The first audio I captured was an actor taking part in the singing.
Seems to hear words of good cheer from everywhere filling the air. Oh, how they pound, raising their sound, o'er hill and dale telling their tale. Gaily they ring while people sing songs of good cheer.
There were several other active mics showing in the display as well. You'll notice the signal strength fluctuated a lot as the actors and actresses moved around the stage. It's also worth me pointing out the settings I used for receiving the wireless mics. I set the SDR software to wide FM mode and set the bandwidth to between 100 and 150 kHz. I also set my tuning step size to 25 kHz, which helped me click on the active frequencies with a little more accuracy. As you can hear, the audio was quite clear with these settings when the mics were in range. One of the problems I was having is that the theatre that was hosting the musical is actually located below ground. So, when I was outside, I had to locate myself right at the back of the theatre to be able to pick up the signals. Had I been able to stay in the lobby, I would have been able to receive much more. My computer didn't like being operated at minus 25 Celsius, and soon the recording became choppy. But during this time, I received actors both on and off stage.
Red up front, then white, then green. We went through this at the training. Red increases sales by...
It's always fun listening in to the backstage chatter when an actor leaves the stage. You'll often hear them commenting on their own performance, or the performances of their colleagues, or levels of audience reaction, and so on. Of course, there's also private conversations that take place, but for the sake of privacy, I did not record these. My next fail came when my laptop battery died. It's several years old and doesn't last long anymore, but it depleted within minutes of being operated at minus 25. I had planned on monitoring from the lobby with my laptop plugged in, but this obviously had not been the reality. Quite often at the theatre, it's difficult to spot the mics worn by actors. The body packs are usually concealed in clothing or accessories, and there are several mic types that are used. The first are these hairline mics. In the production photo here, some of the actors are wearing these. They are creatively positioned below hats, wigs, or natural hairlines, rendering them almost completely invisible. When actors are wearing simpler costumes, you can sometimes spot the mics on their head. When you're in the audience, these mics can be quite difficult to see. If you get a little closer though, you can indeed see them. Perhaps you'll notice here the actress on the left is wearing two hairline mics. That's because it's quite common for the main performer to be double mic'd. They'll generally be wearing two mics, two body packs. Ear hooks are also another popular mic, but they can be very difficult to spot, particularly if the performer does not turn that side of their face towards the audience. Then you've got the single or dual over-the-ear headset mics. These are somewhat more visible, so aren't as widely used in professional theatre, but you will often see them in school performances, amateur theatre, churches, conference centres, and in locations where people give speeches. If you're ever able to get a visit to the sound engineer booth or a backstage area, you'll likely see a bank of wireless receivers like this. Here there are 8 receivers picking up signals from various radio mics being used on stage. You can see the frequencies that each unit is tuned to. You'll also probably see antennas that look like this. There may be several of these positioned on either side of the stage, hidden out of sight of the audience. Usually the technicians want the antennas to be located as close as possible to the transmitters so they can acquire the strongest signals possible. Let's have a brief look at some of the receivers up close. The displays on both these units indicate the frequency in use. They both also indicate the manufacturer's group and channel assignments. The Shure receivers here are on group 9, with the first receiver monitoring channel 17 and the second channel 18. The Sennheiser unit is on frequency 790.1 MHz, which has been stored in the receiver as channel 1 in the user bank. The AKG unit here also displays group and channel codes in addition to the frequencies. You'll notice that all three of these receivers display a battery level. This is the reported battery level of the body pack they are monitoring. If batteries start depleting too quickly, a stagehand will be deployed to replace the batteries for that actor or actress in the body pack so the mic doesn't go dead mid-performance. So, where do you look for cordless mic frequencies? For theatres, stadiums, studios, churches and conference venues in the US and Canada, I suggest looking in these ranges. The VHF frequencies are much less popular than the UHF frequencies, but there are still lots of older equipment getting used on these channels. In this video, you'll have noticed the frequencies I was picking up the mics on were mostly in the 500 to 616 MHz range. Some equipment used the 7800 megs band, but that now has a lot of public safety and cellular telephone usage, which means it's being phased out for wireless mics in North America. However, this band is still available for use in parts of Europe. The various manufacturers provide searchable online resources, helping you see what frequencies are available to use in your area. In the Sennheiser search tool here, I loaded up the UK section to see what frequencies are in use there. You'll notice a mix of VHF, UHF and 800 MHz frequencies are available. This ties in with what I received when I used to live in Britain and in Ireland. You'll notice there are allocations in the 1 gig plus region as well. I have never attempted to receive radio mics on these frequencies, but it would certainly be interesting to try it. Similarly, a search of available frequencies in the New York area, customized for the Shure product line, shows the frequency ranges you would expect to receive activity on. Links to both these resources are in the description below. Usually when I visit the theater, I look for other frequencies being used as well. It's common to hear ushers, administration staff, and security guys on the common LMR or PMR frequencies. Some theaters run simplex, others use low-power repeaters, some are analog and some are digital. With my battery dying and me being left, quite literally, out in the cold, I was unable to locate these frequencies on this visit. So that was my third fail of the evening, and it was time to pack up and go home. So next time you visit the theater, why not bring along your software-defined radio and see what you can find? On my previous visits, I have always particularly enjoyed monitoring the production team and the radio mics backstage. It opens your eyes to another dimension of the work that goes on at any theater. What about you? Have you done any monitoring at live performance venues? Comment below and tell us the kind of things that you've been able to receive. If you're not a subscriber, then I welcome you to join the Frugal Radio channel as we explore the magic and mystery of radio together. You're always welcome to comment and even make a donation via the link in the description if you want. I wish you all a joyful and prosperous new year as 2022 beckons. May you be safe, healthy, and enjoy some quality time with your family, friends, and software-defined radios. For now, this is Frugal Radio, out.